Good morning, everyone. My name is Suzanne. I'm the eldest child of Paul and Lorraine Routhier. On behalf of our family, I would like to welcome everyone for attending, whether in person or via streaming. Welcome. I will start with a brief overview of Mum's life, which was put together by my sister Paulette, and then each of the siblings have written their portion of the eulogy, and the three of us will present each one on behalf of them. La Reine Adrienne Lefebvre Routhier was born in St. Paul, Alberta on August 22, 1939 to Emil Lefebvre and Lea Foisy. She was the eldest in a family of 10 children, including Laurette, Annette, Yolande, Jeannine, Carmen, Prosper, Maurice, Roland, and Aline. They lived on a farm, and Mom was no stranger to hard work as she helped Grandma with the younger siblings and Grandpa on the farm. Like many students back in those days, Mom attended school in the Doucet district and the St. Paul School District. After leaving school, Mom stayed on the farm for another year to help Grandma and Grandpa, but the lure of the big city lights of St. Paul had her move there to work at the St. Therese Hospital. Her job entailed many things, but the thing she enjoyed the most was working in the nursery. We don't know the whole story and even the details on how Mom and Dad met. Dad told us he had known the Lefebvre family forever. Dad, being 11 years older than Mom, no doubt caused a few anxious moments for Grandpa Lefebvre, but this would not deter the two lovebirds. On June 2, 1958, they were united in marriage. 10 months to the date, I was born, followed by André, Paulette, Louise, and Vivian. By the time Mom was 24, almost 25, she would be a mother of five, an incredible feat that few of us would be able to tackle today. We were lucky to have Mom at home. All our meals were homemade. Most of our clothes were sewn by Mom. She even did some sewing for other people. We remember a lady by the name of Jean who used to come to the house and have Mom sew her clothes. Rarely was there a Saturday morning that you didn't smell the scent of fresh baked bread. We didn't realize how lucky we were to have such a great mom. In 1968, Mom and Dad would purchase a lot at Horseshoe Bay near St. Paul and would build a cottage that would become central to the family's fun together over the next decade. It didn't matter if it was summer or if it was winter, the cabin was a place that the whole family enjoyed. What a gift, what great memories we have from that little piece of heaven. That same year, Mom started working at the medical clinic for Dr. Decosse and eventually for Doc Wardiak. It was a part-time job, so Mom had the morning to get the troops off to school, and then at 1 o'clock, she was off to work. In 1978, Mom and Dad welcomed the youngest clan member, Paul Jr., and let's be honest, he quickly became the apple of Mom's eye. Mom continued to work at the medical clinic even after Paul, but retired from the clinic in 1981. In 1979, Mom and Dad bought the acreage near Malake, and they stayed there for 25 years. The cabin was eventually sold. The kids grew up, moved away, and had their own kids. Dad and Mom ran Carline Muffler in St. Paul from 1982 to 2004. In 2004, Mom and Dad were finally able to retire and decided to move into St. Paul. The next few years were spent camping and just enjoying life. In 2017, Mom suffered a major stroke and she would eventually be placed at the J.P. Decosse Auxiliary Facility where she remained until her death, January 30th, 2022. Although Mom had never been told that Dad had passed away, and during COVID, there were months where Dad had not been able to visit, We know somehow she knew he was gone and that she needed to go with him. We take solace in the fact that we know they are finally together. Mom is survived by her 6 children, myself, Andre, Paulette, Louise, Vivian, and Paul Jr. Their spouses, 14 grandchildren, 15 great-grandchildren, her siblings, Laurette, Yelaine, Carmen, Maurice, Laurent, Roland, and Aline, and their spouses, and numerous nieces and nephews. Mom was predeceased by her parents, Emil and Lea, her sisters Annette and Jeannine, her brother Prosper, her brothers-in-law Julien and Richard, and the love of her life, Dad. I am presenting the following on behalf of my sister Paulette. À ma chère maman, early in the morning of January 30th, an angel came and took mom's hand and said, come with me. She led mom into a beautiful garden, so fragrant and so peaceful. They walked for a while, and shortly down the path, a familiar face appeared. It was Dad. Finally, they are together again, rejoicing hand in hand where God has promised that he will wipe all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more deaths, no more sorrow, no crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things have passed away. Over the last 5 years, life changed completely for Mom and Dad, but their enduring love couldn't keep them apart, something we saw from our parents from an early age. Definitely, Mom was the disciplinarian in our family. With 5 kids in 5 years and one more 14 years later, you had to be organized and scheduled to maintain some kind of order. It would take me to become Paulette, to become a mom myself, to realize the immense amount of dedication, patience, and love it would take to be able to raise a family that grew to be so close and to be so caring. Mom could do anything. Simple meals, always so delicious. Our outfits are all carved out by her hands and her sewing machine. Fresh bread Saturday mornings, knitting, crocheting, and all the while the kids immaculately clean and Mom always looking like she came out of a magazine. She always made it look so easy. Mom loved camping, and her dad and Dad always took advantage of any opportunity to pack up and go. In their latter years, they didn't venture far. Even going a few miles out of town made Mom so happy. Mom and Dad had a few dogs over the years. Mom attested that the dogs were Dad's, but you would see her often cuddling with one or giving another one a gentle pat. She could give you the impression that she was tough, but on the interior, she was mush. And you could always find a way to make her laugh, and laugh she did. Mom, I will always remember the fun when you came to visit us in Vernon, the cribbage games and the introduction of new beverages. I will always remember how you hated flying, but you bucked up when we said no more driving in the mountains. I will always remember how you held our little Oliver so lovingly, and how even when you suffered a stroke, you wanted to keep our little Ellie when she came to visit some time ago. I will always remember in the last few years when we came to visit how your face lit up with joy, and maybe you didn't know my name always, but you knew I was indeed one of your girls that you had raised, loved, and taught how to be a good person. Mom, I know this wasn't how things were supposed to go. I know if you had had a crystal ball, things might have been different, but we are not in control. God is, and so in God's control, he gave you Dad, a dedicated, loving husband that was by your side as often as he could be, who loved you more than life itself. Now you get to be together forever, and that is the way it was supposed to go. Love you forever, Mama. Paul. Now I'll do my dedication to my mom. My dearest Mama, We are here today so together we can acknowledge and share both our joy in the gift that your life was to us and the pain that your passing brings. Mom, you taught me so many things, but the one that meant the most to me was the importance of family. I will always remember the way you loved our dad. I got teased in school because the two of you would sit side by side in the car. I will remember you taught me to cook and bake, and that my first cooking lesson was at the age of five when you taught me to fry fish. You were such a fashion statement. I used to refer to you as Jackie O. Our house was always immaculate. The meals were superb. Your desserts were out of this world. You taught us to pray, you brought us to church, and you gave us the gift of faith. You made so many things so special. We felt like royalty on our birthdays, and Christmas was the most amazing holiday of the year. My children will always remember you for your loving and welcoming spirit and how you were always happy to have family over. They too remember your love for their grandpa. They remember you as a firm but fair. The tang was always watered down, and they didn't get away with their hand in the cookie jar, but you always had elaborate spreads on the buffet table, and you always made it look so effortless. My children reminded me of how you always cried when they left. They will all sadly miss you. I really wish that the last 5 years of your life would have been different, Mom. I know you never wanted to end up where you did, but with Dad at the lead and all of us doing the best we could to be by your side, I hope it helped ease some of the pain. I know that we had great moments at the auxiliary, times that will live in my heart forever. Mama, you taught us all what is really important in life. To love and support and care for each other and for our families. We are all better off for having known you. It has been my great privilege to be your daughter. On behalf of myself, my husband Rorie, our daughter Jennifer, her husband Bradley, their children Gracen and Sam, and our son Gary, his wife Roz, their children Korbin, Chayton, and Kinslee, you will always be loved, always be missed, and will forever live in our hearts. Till we meet again, Mama. Cheers. Thank you.
My mom was such a beautiful soul, both inside and out. She always cared to look and feel her best. And with that, she always took such good care of us kids. We were known at church as the Little Routhier clan that were always so well put together. My dad always bought mom the best sewing machines, as we were lucky enough to have her make us the nicest clothes, stamped with her love. Her angel food cakes were always a hit at school bake sales, something else she took such pride in. She put so much love in everything she did. Her family was her pride and joy. My mom and dad had the most beautiful relationship, a love story like no other. The last 5 years of mom's life had been hard on all of us, especially our dad. It broke his heart to see mom like that, but he always visited her, held her hand, and always made it known she was still and would always be the love of her life, right till his dying days. Dad always told me that he wanted to go before mom because he said he could never live without her. With Dad having passed away exactly 1 month before Mom, I find comfort knowing that Dad never had to live without her and that they are together again. Mom, you saw me take my first breath, and I saw you take your last. When I walked into your room on the morning of January 30th, and your dad was calling you home, I wasn't ready to let you go, but I knew you would be going into Dad's safe arms. Mom, I love you so much, and I'm gonna miss you forever.
I'll be reading the following on behalf of my brother, Andre. Some of my earliest childhood memories include the many visits to Mom's family homestead, the Lefebvre farm located a few miles northwest of St. Paul. These visits happened for the usual reasons like Christmas, Easter, and anniversaries, but also simply for visiting or having picnics and playing horseshoes in the forested area near the farmhouse. One of my favorite memories is the annual chicken harvest at the farm in the early years, where my parents, aunts, and uncles, and grandparents processed chickens from barn to freezer. Everyone had a job, and it was like watching a well-oiled machine. Going to the farm was always fun, filled with lots of laughs and entertainment, with plenty of good food and company. Mom always encouraged us to attend the Lefebvre and Routhier family gatherings, even when they became fewer as we got older. Mom was a great cook and baker. When we owned a cabin at Horseshoe Bay, it became a usual practice for the sisters to go out wild strawberry picking while I went out fishing for pike with buddies on St. Vincent Lake. Upon returning with the usual catch, Dad would clean the fish and turn over fillets to Mom, who would cook them to their usual crispness for supper, followed by the best strawberry shortcake you could ever imagine. Sitting down for meals together as a family was mandatory. It was not always fun and games at the Routhiers, though. Mom was a stickler for a clean and spotless house. Every day we had a list of chores to complete, and we were all expected to pitch in. Saturday mornings, while every other kid in the community watched cartoons or played hockey, we participated in what was called the gros ménage, where the household underwent a complete scrub down. Weekly, the smell of lest oil permeated the Saturday morning air to reinforce that the house had been returned to its sparkling state. Mr. Clean would have been proud. Most weekends came with a Sunday drive, with Mom glued tightly next to Dad, and whatever number of us kids sprawled strategically throughout the rest of the car, without seatbelts, while our parents puffed on the occasional Cameo menthol cigarettes. Oh, those were the days. From Mom's life, I learned many important things, including cherish and respect your spouse, enjoy time with your family, and love your children. Take the time to build memories, develop strong work ethics. These will help look after the other things. And so I wish you a safe journey now with Mom, with Dad. Thanks for being my mom. The next portion will be mine. When I think of my mom, so many words come to mind. Wife, mom, grandma, great-grandma, daughter, sister, homemaker, seamstress, gardener, chef, baker, crafter, caregiver, bookkeeper, and nurse. She exemplified the type of person who could do pretty much anything she put her mind to. Whether it was a new needlecraft piece, a repair on her kid's scraped jeans that he was told specifically not to slide in at school, or enough baking at Christmas to get you through the entire next year, Mom would just get things done. Mom loved her family dearly, and although she wasn't always one to share it in words, you knew it by the way her eyes would well up whenever any of her kids would depart after a visit. Of course, upon noticing her pending tears, she would promptly slap you on the shoulder and exclaim, "Voyons," usually followed by a good chuckle by all. She was mostly an outward emotional rock, And for being 5 foot nothing, there was very little that seemed to ever really scare her. Unless you were a mouse, of course. Those critters were about the only thing that could ever put fear into her. She had this keen ability to exude confidence, especially in tougher times, that has transitioned to all of her kids. While her approach to life was sometimes very different from my dad, who was undoubtedly the love of her life, they created this perfect symbiosis, where dad would approach things in a calm, quiet manner, mom would approach things with passion and decisiveness. She had this way of letting you know she cared, but she also wasn't going to let you mope around about your situation. Mom knew that often the only way to move forward was to put your head down and get to work. Of course, part of what made mom really special was the incredible relationship she had with our dad. Truly one of the most timeless love stories any of us will ever witness. They were as inseparable as any two lovebirds could ever be. There was never just Paul or just Lorraine. It was always Paul and Lorraine, mom and dad, grandma and grandpa. So when the news came that mom had left our earth exactly a month after dad, no one could truly be surprised. She was just on her way to continue on that most timeless of love stories. And finally, today I'll be reading a poem by my sister Vivian. Drops of you. Stitches weave together, humming away in rhythm. Roses make you smile. My father completes your life. Drops of you begin our lives. Your dedication, your smile, the essence of who you really are. The songs you sing, the love you bring, drops forever encircle our hearts. Walking a line so straight yet curved, hiding behind the pain you've held, clutching on to what you need, the rest crumbles right down by your feet. Drops of you sent as we grieve. A gaze so far it touches the sky, concealed by a life you left in time. We feel your heartbeat, we feel your peace. These are the drops we collect to keep. A second can change the life we've known, trying to take everything we've grown. The path narrows to see what's real. Before you, God, is the only thing. Drops descend as you rise free. A family bent down in prayer, a gift passed on by you with care, no longer belonging to your body, drifting towards what can't be seen. Drops of you left in our dreams. My father awaits with open arms the one true love he left behind. Go to him, for he is there. Take his hand. He's everywhere.
I get where I'm going, on the far side of the sky. The first thing that I'm gonna do is spread my wings and fly. I'm gonna land beside a lion and run my fingers through his mane. Or I might find out what it's like to ride a drop of rain. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years. And I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. I'm gonna walk with my granddaddy, and he'll match me step for step. And I'll tell him how I've missed him every minute since he left. And then I'll hug his neck. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years. And I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down here. So much pain and so much darkness in this world we stumble through. All these questions I can't answer, so much work to do. Get where I'm going, and I see my Maker's face, I'll stand forever in the light of His amazing grace. Yeah, when I get where I'm going,
places. that you just can't wait to take us, and we'll get to spend forever talking about whatever. When I get there, promise you'll track me down and show me around. And I heard that there's no growing. Bet you're up there right now, making plans and writing out all your favorite places that you just can't wait to take us. And we'll get to spend forever talking about whatever. When I get there, promise you'll track me down and show me.
If I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. Now what I'd give for one more day with you. Cause there's a wound here in my heart where something's missing, and they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased, and knowing yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven, they won't be to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. I know the road you walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven,
won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven, yeah, are on the hands that hold you now. Not a day goes by that I don't see you. You live on in all the better parts of me. Until I'm standing with you in the sun, I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run, until I finally see what you can see. Oh, the only scars in heaven, they won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, and even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now.
it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I do is forever.
Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the grace and peace of God our Father, who raised Jesus from the dead, be always with you and with your spirit. My brothers and sisters, we gather to profess our faith in Jesus Christ, who is the resurrection and the life. We pray for our sister, our mother, and our grandmother, Lorraine, that she may be raised up in glory with Jesus Christ to share his eternal glory over death. O God, glory of the faithful and life of the just, by the death and resurrection of whose Son we have been redeemed, look mercifully upon your departed servant, that just as she professed the mystery of our resurrection, so she may merit to receive the joys of eternal happiness through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, listen, I will tell you a mystery. We will not all die, but we all will be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, in the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For this perishable body must put on imperishability, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When this perishable body puts on imperishability, and this mortal body puts on immortality, then the saying that is written will be fulfilled: death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. Together. I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Our God is merciful. The Lord protects the simple. When I was brought low, he saved me. I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. I kept my faith even when I said, I am greatly afflicted. I said in my consternation, everyone is a liar. I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful. O Lord, I am your servant. You have loosened my bonds. I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead has also come through a man. For us all die in Adam, so all will be made alive in Christ, but each in his own order, Christ the first fruits, then at his coming those who belong to Christ. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the gospel. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, Lord. When Jesus arrived at Bethany, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, even though they die, will live. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, the one coming into the world. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. You may be seated. We've just listened to the Word of God, and the passages kind of together remind us that Jesus is the resurrection and the life. So we heard first of all from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians saying, I will tell you a mystery. We will not all die, but we will all be changed. And so we say that the most constant thing in life is the change that we endure from the moment we're conceived, from the moment we're born, from the moment we leave home. There's one change after another, and in a sense we never go back to what we used to be or what we used to have. But all of those changes occur, and then the final change is when we leave this life and we go into eternal life. Paul tells us that death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? And so God gets the last word. When we are sick, God heals us. When we are saddened, God gives us hope. When we die, God gives us eternal life. He takes us away from death so that eternal life may be ours. In our second reading, also from the letter of Paul to the Corinthians, we're told that Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. And so we refer to Jesus as the firstborn. He's the firstborn of Mary, but he's also the firstborn of humanity to enter into eternal life. And whenever we talk about someone being the firstborn, we assume that there's going to be others to follow. And so Jesus, as the firstborn into eternal life, If we belong to him and if we follow his pattern, then as he enters into eternal life, then eternal life is also promised to us. And finally, from the Gospel of John, we have a story that's only in John's Gospel, where Lazarus and Martha and Mary were friends of Jesus. Jesus gets word that Lazarus is close to death. And instead of dropping everything, he waits. And he comes 4 days later, after Lazarus has already been in the tomb. And so the sentiment of Mary is perhaps a little bit like our own. She says to Jesus, "If you had been here, my brother would not have died." In our own prayer, we kind of say, "Lord, if you'd only listened to us, our mother would not have died. The sickness would not have progressed. Our circumstances would have been a lot different. Why didn't you listen to us? Why did you have to wait?" And of course, Jesus reminds her that there is something greater than simply being cured from the sickness that he had. And so while Martha and Mary were concerned about Lazarus dying, they wanted to preserve him from death. What Jesus ultimately does is show that he is the author of life, and that it's not just death that we worry about, but that eternal death. And Jesus gives him eternal life. Jesus asks Martha, "Do you believe that I am the resurrection and the life?" And she said, "Of course I believe. You are the Christ, the Son of God. You are the anointed one." And so in turn, if we recognize that we too have been anointed in baptism, we too have been claimed by Christ. And so our prayers for one another are effective in helping one another. Our prayers for the dead in the same way assist them in their final journey. And as we pray for them, we also ask the departed to pray for us. We're still, in a sense, in the boat together. They're in heaven, but we're on earth, and together we help one another that we may glorify God, that we may see God continually at work in our lives.
sun. We've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Let us praise Jesus Christ in the mystery of his death and resurrection. Blessed are you forever. Together, blessed are you forever. Blessed are you, Lord Jesus, firstborn from the dead. Blessed are you forever. Blessed are you, Lord Jesus, promise of the ages fulfilled. Blessed are you forever. Blessed are you, Lord Jesus, our resurrection and life. Blessed are you forever. Blessed are you, Lord Jesus, word of life to all who listen. Blessed are you forever. Blessed are you, Lord Jesus, life-giving water of eternal life. Blessed are you forever. Blessed are you, Lord Jesus, living bread for your pilgrim people. Blessed are you forever. Blessed are you, Lord Jesus, soothing oil for the suffering and the sick. Blessed are you forever. Blessed are you, Lord Jesus, healer of broken hearts. Blessed are you forever. Blessed are you, Lord Jesus, hope of everlasting life for all who yearn for heaven. Blessed are you forever. Please stand. With longing for the coming of God's kingdom, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Father of mercies and God of all consolation, you pursue us with untiring love, and you dispel the shadow of death with the bright dawn of life. Comfort your family in their loss and sorrow. Be their refuge and strength, O Lord, and lift them from the grief, from the depths of grief, into the peace and light of your presence. Your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by dying, has destroyed our death, and by rising, has restored our life. Enable us, therefore, to press on towards him, so that after our earthly course is run, he may reunite us with those we love, when every tear will be wiped away. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed are those who have died in the Lord, and let them rest from their labors, for their good deeds go with them. Eternal rest grant unto her, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon her. May she rest in peace. Amen. And may her soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. May the peace of God, which is beyond all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated for a few moments.
Trusting in God, we have prayed together for Lorraine, and now we come to the last farewell. There is sadness in parting, but we can take comfort in the hope that one day we shall see her again and enjoy her friendship. Although we will disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the joy of his kingdom. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith of Jesus Christ. In baptism, Lorraine shared in the death and resurrection of Christ. May she be welcomed into the glory of eternal life. As a sign of respect for our sister, our mother, and grandmother, we let our prayers rise like incense to God, who has called her to share in his glory. I know that my Redeemer lives, and on the last day I shall rise again. In my body I shall look on God my Savior. In my body I shall look on God my Savior. I myself shall see him. My own eyes will gaze on him. In my body I shall look on God my Savior. This is the hope I cherish in my heart. In my body I shall look on God my Savior. Please stand. Father of mercies, into your hands we commend our sister in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for all the blessings which you bestowed upon Lorraine throughout her life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain behind to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our sister forever. My dear friends, may every mark of affection and every mark and every gesture of friendship that we give to others be a sign of God's peace for you. In peace, let us take our sister to her place of rest.
A bright sunrise will contradict the heavy fall that weighs you down. In spite of all the funeral songs, the birds will make their joyful sounds. You wonder why the earth still moves. You wonder how you carry on. But you'll be okay on that first day when I'm gone. Dusk will come with fireflies and whippoorwill and crickets call, and every star will take its place in silvery gown and purple shawl. You'll lie down in our big bed, dread the dark and dread the dawn. But you'll be all right on that first night when I'm gone.